Don't worry about it.
So I can tell him how I am so thankful.
Welcome to today's broadcast. This is A Little As Much radio program brought to you by Bible Baptist Church of Independence, Missouri. Well, I don't have the Kurt Cooper's with us today, but I've got someone else in our church. He's named Mike Lackey, and he plays guitar, and we're going to bring him up here. I'm going to let him sing. Go ahead, Mike.
Okay.
Mike is just one of our members at the church, and you know, as I said last week, about half my church is made up of people who used to be in the Catholic Church, and Mike got saved and got out.
Amen.
And now he's singing for the Lord, and Mike goes on the street with us, and he preaches. Married, tell you, probably the world's greatest cook, Dieta, and she was a Mennonite gal, and she got saved. So God's been good to every member in our church. Now, I have a special prayer request before we get into our study today. Last couple of weeks, we've had the Cooper family up here singing with us. Now, something has developed. They were going to travel on, but Joni, the mother in the family, she came down with a case of chicken pox. Now, she's in her, I believe, 40s, and she got chicken pox. And that would be one thing, but that has spread, I think, to a couple other members of the church. There's a family of four that may be getting it. But the youngest member of the Cooper family is Sarah. Now, she had a liver transplant when she was 5 years old, and because of that, it is very serious condition if she gets the chicken pox, and it could kill her. And so we're asking you, if you've been listening to this radio broadcast and you love God and the Bible, if you just say a prayer for Sarah Cooper. And right now, Joni and Sarah have to be quarantined from each other for 14 days. So they're going to be with us for a while, and mother and daughter cannot even be in the same room. And if she does break out in the chicken pox, they're going to put her in the hospital. She went down for a checkup just the other day and had to wear a mask just to get into Children's Mercy. So one day what I'll have do is I'll put Brian on and Sarah, and I'll just take the radio time to explain the miracle that took place in Sarah's life by getting that transplanted liver. So if you'll pray for Sarah, we'd appreciate it. All right, now if you'll take your Bible today, and we're going to go into 2 Corinthians chapter 7. 2 Corinthians chapter 7. We're going to talk about biblical repentance today. Now, what is repentance? Now, if you asked the common person what repentance is, they'd probably give you a variation of answers. And before we get into what it is, I want to talk to you about how important it is. It's in fact, Jesus Christ used the word, and he taught, and he preached it. In Luke chapter 13, verse 3, it says that, except ye repent, ye shall all likewise perish. Right there in that same chapter, in Luke chapter 13, he says the very same thing in verse 5. Jesus said, except ye repent, ye shall all likewise perish. So Jesus preached it, and he said, unless you have it, you'll perish. It must be real important. In fact, repentance is the old turn or burn type of sermons used to hear all across this land. John the Baptist preached it. He says, repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. Jesus preached it again. It says, from that time, Jesus began to preach and say, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Peter, one of the disciples, preached it. He said, repent ye therefore, and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out. In Acts chapter 17, the Apostle Paul, he preached it by saying that God commandeth every man everywhere to repent. And over in 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 9, the Bible says, the Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness, but is long-suffering to usward, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come unto repentance. So, my friend, you can see how many times that's being preached by the greatest characters in the Bible. It must be important. And what I believe is wrong with our country, what's wrong with our churches, and if you want to know why Christianity holds no power with God or holds no power with man any longer, it is because of this thing about repentance. My friend, if you don't repent, you can't be saved. In fact, the Bible makes it very clear that repentance comes before believing on Jesus Christ. In Mark chapter 1, verse 15, it says, the time is fulfilled, and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent ye and believe the gospel. So repentance comes before believing. Now, you know, I've been saved for 20 years, and I've talked to a lot of people about their soul, and a lot of people will say something like this. You ask them about being saved, and they'll say it like this. And I hope you out there in radio land don't say this. If somebody asks you if you're saved, and you say something like this, oh, yeah, yeah, I did that. Yeah, a long time ago, yeah. I can see by the joy on your heart there. You know, it makes me wonder when you give an answer like that, and yet many Americans do. You ask them, are you saved? Listen, if you're saved, you're saved from something. You're saved from hell, a lake of fire. And that's all the enthusiasm that you can bring forth. Now, listen, when God saved Mark Velder 20 years ago, I knew what I was saved from, and it was quite an experience. When I realized I couldn't go to hell, I was happy about that. I was full of joy about that. But what we're getting by knocking on doors and street preaching, we call it the zombie crowd, or the day of the living dead, or night of living dead. You ask the average person if they've been saved, and it's something like, yeah, I remember when I was a kid, I went down to the altar, and I asked Jesus into my heart. And you know, it sounds like they're stoned. Now, what is that? Now, what I believe you have got going on here in the Christianity of America is a lot of people do go down, they ask Jesus into their heart, but they've never repented. Remember, my friend, repentance comes before believing. You can say, listen, the devil believes in God. He's never repented. The demons believe in God, but they've never repented. And they're going to a lake of fire. So, my friend, maybe you're duped, either by self or by a false religion or the devil himself, that you're going to heaven, but maybe not. The Bible says, examine yourself whether ye be in the faith. Now, America needs some preaching on repentance. Now, what is it? Let's talk about that for a little bit. What is it? Is it reform? Is it a new leaf? Is it a fresh start? My friend, is it a promise to do right? Is it confessing one's sin? Is it penance? Is it the feeling of sorrow? Is it a bunch of tears? Is it remorse? Now, by those standards, most of the people who get caught for some kind of a criminal action are saved and going to heaven. You realize that you can feel bad about doing something and go straight to hell? That is not biblical repentance. Now, true repentance may include all of those things or one of those things, but I'm going to give you some definitions from the Bible on what true biblical repentance is. And this is so important. As we started out the program here, without repentance, man, you cannot get to heaven. Jesus Christ said, except ye repent, ye shall all likewise perish. So this is good for your soul. And my friend, if you don't know the Lord Jesus Christ, if you died today and you don't know where you'd spend eternity, eternity, then this is for you.